Most of the things that have always been aggravating to me is that we have had a policy that makes one superior to the other.
A Somali woman who has a hijab getting sworn in on a Quran, a massive Quran.
I stand here before you tonight as your Congresswoman-elect.
The new Congress sworn in yesterday is the most diverse in U.S. history. Ilhan Omar of Minnesota and Rashida Tlaib of Michigan.
Not only did we have the America we believed in, but the America we deserve.
We believe that we are strong and that forward together we will come out of this.
I am America's hope and the president's nightmare.
There it is, President Trump. Have some Somali tea. Are you there to cause chaos?
I mean, they could hear us coming from afar. And I...
Their allies believe they have been unfairly singled out because of their religion.
Of course, the minute two Muslim women arrive in Congress, they're going to get attacked as anti-Semitic if they're critical of Israel.
I think she should either resign from Congress or she should certainly resign from the House Foreign Affairs Committee.
Not right.
That was not a question.
Committee can attack.
On, do you think that massacre was a fabulous achievement? Young kids who are being put in cages. That is not in line with our values.
They're really frustrated with their critics, and they see hypocrisy among their critics.
How this president is a liar in chief, how this president isn't really rooted in any reality. What we have is a problem of moral courage.
The stories of our grandparents and great-grandparents who were immigrants themselves, and the contributions that they made to create this great nation, we're not that much different from one another. This country gave us hope. This country allowed for us to develop our own identity and to create our own home, and we shouldn't look down on the next person that's trying to do that.
You guys can sit, please. Oh. You can turn back the lights back on. Makes this light a little less harsh. Assalamu alaikum, everyone. I also want the light so I could see your beautiful faces. I am truly, truly, truly honored for the opportunity to be here with all of you. It's been a really hard week for the Muslim community, and I feel extremely lucky to be here in California with all of you fighting for justice, for equality, for the right for us to equally exist in this country. Many people expect our community to feel like it needs to hide every time something happens. But repeatedly, we have shown them that we are not to be bullied, we are not to be threatened, we are not to be terrorized. We are strong, resilient, and we will always show up to be ourselves because we know we have a right to a dignified existence and a dignified life. The other thing that is exciting to me to be in this room is that there are very fascinating people outside who for so many years have spoken about an Islam that is oppressive. An Islam that lessens and isolates its women. And today they gather outside to protest a Muslim woman who is in Congress. I mean, the irony in that is very entertaining to me. I know many of them drove miles to get here, spent a lot of energy and resources and money to purchase the signs that they have. But I don't think any of them realize that people like myself and many of the people in this room can care less about what they have to say, because we know who we are and where we belong and what we stand for. So we are coming off a tragic, tragic nightmare that has happened to Muslims in New Zealand. Many of us know that this is not a one-off incident. Many of us were not shocked or surprised. Many of us were kind of holding our breath for a really long time, thinking, when will something like this happen? Because many of us have experienced threats in our mosques, in our schools, even for our individual leaders. Many of us have witnessed bombings of mosques. Many of us have seen mosques set on fire. Many people a few years ago watched in horror as gunmen showed up to Irving, Texas, at a mosque threatening Muslims. So we all kind of knew that this was happening. But the reason I think that many of us knew that this was going to get worse is that we finally have a leader, a world leader, in the White House who publicly says Islam hates us, who fuels hate against Muslims, who think it is okay to speak about a faith and a whole community in a way that is dehumanizing, vilifying, and doesn't understand, or at least makes us want to think that he doesn't understand the consequences that his words might have. Some people, like me, know that he understands the consequences. He knows that there are people that he can influence to threaten our lives, to diminish our presence. But what we know and what Islam teaches us and what I always say is that love trumps hate. Every time we feel threatened, we show up with love, and others stand with us in solidarity. We've seen that with the Muslim ban, a very hateful policy that has now been fully implemented, one that is going to leave a stain in our nation's history. When the ban was first announced, Muslims across this country rushed out to stand against it. And everyone else in all of our communities showed up alongside us. We also know that when this last shooting happened, even though leaders, non-Muslim leaders, said people should not go to Jummah prayers, people should not show up at their mosques, we knew that the only way we will continue is for all of us to show up And even if you were not planning on going to Juma prayer, that Friday you were going to Juma prayer. And we knew that others within our communities will also show up. Because that is how it works. Once you are willing to stand up for yourself, once you recognize what your rights are, what you should be entitled to, then others will show up for you. Liberation is not an external thing. It's an internal thing. People always say to me, how have you gotten empowered? And I say, I was born this way. It is not about how others make us feel. It is what we tell ourselves that we are worthy. So when you know as a Muslim that advancing justice is very inherent in you, when you know as a Muslim, our faith's initial foundations were built by a prophet who was vilified, had stones and fruit and all kind of things thrown at him. A prophet who had to make a pilgrimage and leave his home. Then you know that when Ilhan is facing some controversy, that is not something to be afraid of. We might be headed to the promised land of speaking the truth and finding our external liberty once we internally liberate ourselves. Muslims for a really long time in this country have been told that there is a privilege, that there is a privilege that we are given, and it might be taken away. We are told that we should be appropriate. We should go to school, get an education, raise our children, and not bother anyone. Not make any kind of noise. Don't make anyone comfortable. Be a good Muslim. But no matter how much we have tried to be the best neighbor, people have always worked on finding a way to not allow for every single civil liberty to be extended to us. You can clap for that. So the truth is, you can go to school and be a good student. You can listen to your dad and mom and become a doctor. You can have that beautiful wedding that makes mom and dad happy. You can buy that beautiful house. But none of that stuff matters if you one day show up to the hospital and your wife or maybe yourself is having a baby and you can't have the access that you need because someone doesn't recognize you as fully human. It doesn't matter how good you were. If you can't have your prayer mat and take your 15-minute break to go pray in a country that was founded on religious liberty. It doesn't matter how good you are. If you one day find yourself in a school where other religions are talked about, but when Islam is mentioned, we are only talking about terrorists. And if you say something, you are sent to the principal's office. So to me, I say raise hell. Make people uncomfortable. Because here's the truth. Here's the truth. Far too long, we have lived with the discomfort of being a second-class citizen. And frankly, I'm tired of it, and every single Muslim in this country should be tired of it. CAIR was founded after 9/11 because they recognized that some people did something and that all of us were starting to lose access to our civil liberties. So you can't just say that today someone is looking at me strange, that I am going to try to make myself look pleasant. You have to say, this person is looking at me strange, I am not comfortable with it, I am going to go talk to them and ask them why. Because that is a right you have. So there are people, and Hassan is on the right track. It's always good, right? I say you can't hate up close. You can't hate up close. Anytime you have an opportunity to go talk to someone, the chances of them hating you lessens. So that is a practice we should all adopt. But the one thing that has always been very fascinating to me, and Hassan and I were talking about this before I came down here, is that there are always these folks who have ayahs prepared in their head. It's part of their talking points. And I don't think, I mean, I'm not, a hafiz. I don't know. I don't know what, chapter 4, 1, 3, 5 says in the Quran. Any Muslim in here know what that is? No? Okay. Hassan does. That's expected, I suppose. But it goes, right? They're always putting these ayah numbers. And I'm like, I really don't know. Let me get back to you. I don't even know how to Google that yet. But there was a woman, again, who we're not going to mention, and she was talking to Hassan outside. He went to go talk to her because Hassan is brave like that. And so in their conversation, she's, right, like saying all of these chapter numbers and ayah numbers, first numbers and chapter numbers. And I thought about it. I said, you know, we should like just kind of do that. I started a practice, and I'm hoping, you know, Muslims who are elected around the country would just do this. I tweet out verses of the Quran. I say assalamu alaikum and all, you know, alhamdulillah. I tweet back at people, astaghfirullah. I mean, I'm trying to make sure that people are Googling these words. I never really put the definition there, because I want them to get comfortable as they Google what they mean. So I was thinking that, you know, I should think about maybe some ayahs that kind of explain why someone like me exists. And to me, it is really important because there is not enough conversation rooted in the fact that advocacy, fighting for justice, standing up for what is right, is very inherently Islamic. So for those of you who want to Google this ayah, it's in chapter 4, wow. 135, and I'll paraphrase it. This ayah says that as Muslims, we are called on, right, to stand up for justice and to speak the truth. Even if it is against ourselves, our parents, and our close relatives. If Hassan was up here, he'd probably say it in Arabic. But I'm work in progress, so that's all I got. And And so when people, you know, are having these conversations with me and they say, you know, Ilhan, why do you criticize Muslims who are doing something? What is your problem with Arab countries? Why are you always talking about, you know, this particular country and you're not talking about that particular country? My choice of a country to talk about is not my preference of country. It is based on what country is violating basic human rights. So it doesn't matter if that country is being run by my father, my brother, my sister, I will still criticize that country because I know every country is capable of living out to their best. Every leader has the ability to lead with compassion, to lead with justice. So it is important for us to recognize that and to make sure that we're not only holding people that we don't like accountable. We must also hold those that we love, have shared values with, accountable. And so I am, again, very grateful to have the opportunity to be in a room like this with all of you. As an elected Muslim in Congress, I feel the weight of responsibility that I have to not live up to the name of being a Muslim, but live up to the ideals of what it means to be a Muslim. And I know as an American member of Congress, I have to make sure that I am living up to the ideals of fighting for liberty and justice. Those are very much rooted in the reason why my family came here. And so, regardless of how hard Washington might get for me or your neighborhoods might get for you, you have to always remember that we have a mission as humans to love one another, to care for our neighbors, to raise compassionate children, and to fully every single day show up and make sure that we are furthering justice. Thank you so much for having me, and have a great night.